Welcome to worship, friends in Christ. Thanks be to the Lord Jesus as he gathers us in, online worshipers and in-person worshipers. Online folks, I'm not sure how often we're in communication with each other. I know that among us are folks who've been having some travels this summer, and I'm one of them. I'm one of them who has had a travel this summer, and I'll share more about that. But please feel free. Feel free to, during our open announcement time, folks here, maybe you want to share something. Maybe you've had some experience in the last week or the last month where you had such a sense of gratitude to your Heavenly Father, or maybe a prompting of the Holy Spirit. That's fine, too, in-person friends in the announcement time. I'm inviting us all to be in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, you who are sovereign, free, almighty, and who love us tenderly, gently, you tell us we are precious to you. Thank you that you gather us in for worship. We come from different directions, even if the Flathead is our home. We come from different experiences, different events that we all have moved through in this past week. Thank you, Christ Jesus, you who are the risen Lord, for gathering us together, giving us that sense of wonder, that sense of awe with your Spirit in this place. We trust in you to renew us, to re-energize us, and give us clarity, that wisdom, that discernment, as we move through this next week. Thanks be to you for freedom to worship and serve, freedom to pray and study, freedom to witness to the power of your amazing, astonishing, never-ending grace. We pray through you, Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Friends, I invite you to stand as we join together in our call to worship. And then we'll remain standing for our praise song. Keep bright in us the vision of days when war shall cease. Till dawns the morning glorious, when truth and justice reign.
And Christ shall rule victorious over all the world's domain.
We join together in For the Healing of the Nation.
Just
be seated, sisters and brothers. We're turning to our prayer of confession, and then we'll have music as we reflect on those words, and then I will offer pastoral words of assurance, and after that, we'll join together in the prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us. Let us pray. You knew betrayal in your life, O Christ. One whom you loved turned against you. Our lives are filled with betrayals. Men and women and whole communities turn against one another. Strengthen us in the way of faithfulness, O Christ, that we may be true to you, to our own depths, and to one another. Amen. Scripture tells us that each one of us is created in the image of God, and that we who follow Jesus are growing in his likeness, growing in the likeness of Christ. He experienced the fullness of human sinfulness. Other people brought that to him when he was here on this earth. Indeed, he knows what it is to be betrayed or perhaps deserted or abandoned. Whatever experience we've had of other people who may have let us down, or our own letting down of other people, know that through the grace of God, through the love of Jesus, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, each one of us is accepted, forgiven, and loved. Thanks be to the Holy Trinity. Then let's share as the Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And then we have the traditional celebrating the reappointment of pastor. This is actually only in the hard copy of our bulletin. I have a shortened version of the traditional reappointment, and it's simply responsive reading. Just like when we celebrate Holy Communion with the full liturgy, we have an opportunity to offer one another forgiveness, to move along that path toward reconciliation and greater intimacy with Christ at the center of our relationships. So do we have that here. So congregation, your part, as always, is in bold. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I reaffirm today my commitment to lead as your pastor and to serve our neighbors in Kalispell. Forgive me for mistakes I have made and for harm I have caused this past year.
Forgive us for mistakes we have made and for harm we have caused this past year.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Eternal God, revive us as we receive your vision for our faith family and our community. Give us patience, courage, and wisdom. Help us grow in grace and follow the Lord Jesus wherever he leads. Through your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good morning. In the midst of his children, the Lord said he would be. It doesn't take very many. It can be just two or three. And I feel that same sweet spirit that I felt oft times before. Surely I can say I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. There's a holy hush around us as God's glory fills this place. I've touched the hem of his garment. I can almost see his face, and my heart is overflowing with the fullness of his joy. I know without a doubt that I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I can glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Thank you, Bob and Don. Yes, thanks be to God. Have just a bit of not exactly Bible background, but reminding us where we are in the book of Acts. These last few weeks, last couple of months, we've had an opportunity through the lectionary and sometimes through other sources to be able to be with Paul and others who are sent to share the good news of God's love through Christ Jesus. So right now, where we are, there are four named followers of Jesus who are sent from Jerusalem in Judea to Antioch in Syria. So they go north, sent up to Antioch in Syria to address conflict there. And they are Paul, the one we used to know as Saul, Paul, Barnabas, Judas, who is also called Barsabbas, and Silas. So those four. They go because those Followers in Antioch are facing a perennial question, meaning a question that all of us sisters and brothers in Christ face every day, and that is, how shall we live together, church? How shall we live together, body of Christ? And just as our scripture last week encouraged us, we know we are called, each one of us, to live freely, animated by God's Spirit, motivated by God's Spirit, as we also embrace every other brother and sister in Christ living freely, animated, motivated by God's Spirit. And we're able to do that through the grace of God. So these four followers do address the issues in Antioch, and then Silas and Barsabbas return to Jerusalem. That brings us to Acts chapter 15, verses 36 through 41. After some days, Paul said to Barnabas, "Come, let us return and visit the brothers and sisters in every city where we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are doing." Barnabas wanted to take with them John called Mark, but Paul decided not to take with them one who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not accompanied them in the work. The disagreement became so sharp that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and set out, the brothers and sisters commending him to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. We know very little about this sharp disagreement between Barnabas and Paul. We can come all the way up to the year 2022 and know that if there were folks maybe who weren't necessarily famous, but they might be local figures, we would probably know something about a sharp disagreement because we would see something about that posted in social media, or in the olden days before that, if we were observers of the disagreement or heard from this one and this one and this one, we may even be discussing this disagreement. But of course, there's no digital footprint from the first century, no thread for us to hop onto. Paul did leave some hard copy letters, and then Luke himself left this narrative. This is the narrative, the description that we know as the Acts of the Apostles, but it still doesn't tell us much about the disagreement. You can go back a couple chapters in Acts, and you can see in Acts chapter 13, verse 13, a little different description of how it was that John Mark was no longer with the group. Quote, "Then Paul and his companions set sail from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia. John, however, left them and returned to Jerusalem," end quote. So at least here, Luke does not characterize John Mark's return to Jerusalem as desertion. However, as you heard in chapter 15, Luke actually says what we are to interpret as Paul's perspective on Mark's behavior, that at least in Paul's view, Mark deserted them. So that might carry with it some sense of abandonment, maybe even betrayal. It was certainly parting company. In the many translations of the Bible, many will use that same word, deserted, in chapter 15. And yet others say Mark departed, Mark left, or Mark withdrew. And so that can bring us again back to last week's scripture, just a tie into the reality of how the self can creep in, and how each one of us persons may have different views of events that are occurring around us, and different views on what people say and what people do. Here, Barnabas and Paul, two people, can observe a third person's behavior. They can observe John Mark's behavior, and they can have what appeared to be opposite views of that behavior. Luke makes it clear for us that Paul is not ready to give Mark a second chance, at least at this point. Paul will not risk trusting Mark again, although Barnabas will. And Paul is not open to any possibility God may have through reconciling, through an ongoing relationship, continuing to communicate and relate with Mark, although Barnabas is willing, is open. So whatever redemption God intends for these followers, whatever transformation that Christ dreams for these followers, at least for Paul and Mark, and for Paul and Barnabas, that redemption, that transformation in this immediate future, it comes through parting company. We'll look at a slide. We actually have some sermon slides, and so in just a moment, we'll have that image of parting company. So again, on a variety of translations, I looked in a variety of translations, many scriptures will use that phrase, parting company. Many versions of the Acts of the Apostles will use that phrase, parting company, like we heard. Others will say, they separated, they went separate ways, each went his own way. Most of us who have been a part of the body of Christ have experienced this. We ourselves have been sisters and brothers who have parted, who have gone different directions, or we've been with other brothers and sisters as they parted, as they went in different directions. Thank you. Sometimes the parting company comes through death, and since we are resurrection people, we trust, we have that hope of the resurrection, and we trust that when we are raised in the Lord Jesus, when we die, that we will be reunited with those other followers who've already been raised. Sometimes the parting company comes through a geographic move. Other times the parting company comes through a different kind of movement. It may be a movement of the heart, a movement of the soul, a movement of the mind that then is actually expressed in a movement of the body. We all know that people experience changes in their relationships with other people, and that includes with other people in the body of Christ. They also experience changes in their journey with Jesus, and sometimes these changes can lead them to a different faith family. I have shared before that from a pastoral perspective, I support people finding their fit within the body of Christ. We know that through the grace of God in the risen Lord Jesus, there is no coercion, there is no manipulation. And so we trust the Holy Spirit's call to you, that each one of you will find your fit, will find your sense of belonging. And that sense of belonging, that fit that you find with the Christian community, it may change as you, the individual, change. It may change as the faith family, the Christian community, changes. A value that pastors have for all folks is authenticity, that you all be able to connect with the body of Christ and ways that are authentic for you, genuine, real. The prayer we had together, our prayer of confession, John Philip Newell in that prayer gives us that call to be true to our own depths, true to our own depths, to our own soul, even as we're true to the Lord Jesus and true to others in community. Today, I tell a story of two followers who parted company some 5 centuries after Barnabas and John Mark and Paul. Last month, I had a wonderful spiritual retreat with John Philip Newell, the one who authored our prayer. And that was on the island of Iona, off the coast of Scotland, off the west coast. And during that 1 week retreat, I had the gift of immersing myself in this story that I share today. The parting company happened in the North Atlantic, so yes, in both Scotland and Ireland. And we'll look at a slide as we look at one of those followers. One follower is Columba. You can see he was born in 521 and he died in 597. His Celtic name is Columkill, Columkill, which means dove of the church. And so Column in Gaelic or Columba in Latin, that means dove, and Columkill is the dove of the church. So on the left is a photo of a dove, and this is actually a photo I took of a stole that I brought back with me from Iona. This dove is in the tartan that is known as the Iona Sound. So you may be aware, not only do clans have characteristic tartans, but regions have characteristic tartans, and the island of Iona has that Iona Sound. So reminiscent for folks there of colors on the island and in the surrounding waters. On the right is a stained glass window of Columba, and you might be able to tell he has a dove perched on his hand. Thank you. Columba was born to a royal family in Ireland, and at this time in the 500s, there were chieftains. They may have been considered kings of a smaller area, maybe even minor kings. There would be several kings, each having different territory, but then there was also a high king who was the overlord of Ireland. So Columba was a prince born to become chieftain, or at least king in his area, as was the custom for nobility at this time. As a boy, he was sent to train in monasteries, at least two different monasteries. And during his time there in the monasteries as a boy and as a youth, he developed skills as a scribe, so writing, and as an illuminator, the one who could do the beautiful pictures or that enhanced writing around the letters and around the sentences. He also excelled in scholarship, and he practiced the art of creating poetry and prayers. The monks called Columba the dove of the church, Columkill, because at least when he was a young boy, they would often find him, they would say, nesting near the altar as he was deep in prayer. So the name Columkill, the dove of the church. Eventually, as a youth, Columba heard Christ calling him to full-time Christian service, and so he gave up his princely rights, and he started off on that vocation as a monk. We'll look at another slide to see the second person in this controversy. One of Columba's teachers was Finian of the Monastery of Clonard. Finian is known as the teacher of the saints of Ireland. And there he is teaching a few of those saints. Thank you. Both Finian and his student Columba have been canonized as saints. And so sometimes to stay with the tradition, I'll refer to them as Saint Columba or Saint Finian. A reminder for all of us, in our United Methodist tradition, we use the word saint the same way that the Apostle Paul uses the word saint in his letters in the New Testament. So for us, saint is a brother or sister in Christ, a follower of Jesus, a Christian. It's one who follows Jesus, who has a relationship with the Lord Jesus. Finian had a copy of a special book. This special book was the Psalter, so just the Hebrew Bible. It was a copy of the Psalms that a couple centuries before a theologian named Jerome had translated. So translated from the Hebrew of the Hebrew Bible into Latin, which at that point in time folks were, those who had the privilege of being able to read, folks were able to read and to speak. Columba was drawn to the Psalter itself, to the beauty of the Psalms, to how heartfelt the Psalms are, to the full range of emotion that the psalmist expresses to the Lord God. And he was also drawn to this book, to the Psalter, this object that his teacher Finian had. Without telling Finian, Columba started copying the Psalter, hidden though, he did that. He would get the Psalter and then he would go hide and he would copy it. And his intention was to be able to have his very own copy of the Psalter. And so again, if we can just think about a timeline, this is almost 1,000 years before the printing press. And so you can imagine that labor of love, painstakingly to copy the Psalter, to take that time and energy to do it, and then to do it under cover of darkness, so to speak. There was all kinds of strategy needed to be able to do that. Down the road, I'll share more about illuminated manuscripts and gospels that came out of Iona later in Columba's life. So Finian discovered that Columba was copying the Psalter, and it was basically when Columba was almost finished or had finished. And Finian demanded that Columba give the copy to him. Columba refused. Columba argued that since he had done all of the work, the copy belonged to him. Finian brought this controversy, this matter in issue, to the High King, so the overlord of all of Ireland. And the High King ruled in favor of Finian. He said, "To every cow belongs her calf, to every book belongs its copy." Now, we have some missing pieces here. We don't know how it is that teacher Finian received the copy he had of Jerome's Psalter, right? So that would be interesting if we had any hard copy evidence of that, which so far I haven't found any in my research. So Columba was angry. He was angry with Finian, and he was angry with the High King. This was one incident that was fuel for a fire for parting company. Then there was another incident, and here the tale has a little different timeline on the history. Some say this other incident happened before the incident with the book. Others say this incident happened after the incident with the book. All that we need to know is there were at least two incidents that stoked the fire of Columba's resentment that then enraged him. This other incident also involved the High King. And Columba had a clansman who had accidentally killed one of the king's clan in sport, in a game. And it was a mistake, it was an accident. And so that clansman sought sanctuary where Columba was serving. And yet the king told his soldiers not to honor that protection of sanctuary, not to honor that practice of providing sanctuary, and instead the king's soldiers dragged the clansman out and killed him. So whichever the order of these two events, we know that they broke the camel's back. One of them was the straw for Columba. And so Columba raised his clan and others to go to battle against the armies of the High King and others who sided with the king. And this battle was actually known as the Battle of the Book, the Battle of the Book of the Psalter. When the battle was all over, 3,000 people were dead. 3,000. If you can say there were sides, 3,000 altogether. Lost in battle. When Columba finally realized that magnitude of the destruction that he had caused. Yes, others, but he, from his own viewpoint, he had ignited. He repented of this violence. And again, different ways of telling the story. Some will say that it was an order of the church and of the king that exiled him. Others will say that he chose to leave in exile as penance. However it came about, there is a phrase that has come down, a vow that has come down through the centuries, that Columbus said, "I will not rest until I have won for God as many souls as the men who have fallen in this battle." And so in 563, Columba and 12 other followers set out from Ireland in a small boat. So they set out to the east in a small boat to be exiled from their homeland. And they landed first on an island where they could still see Ireland. But Columba knew that he could not stay there. He knew that every time he would see the hills of his homeland across the water, that his longing would be so strong that he would not be able to resist returning to the place of his birth. And so he and the 12 sailed on to the first island where they could no longer see Ireland, no longer see his homeland, and that was the island of Iona. So another slide where we can see a map, get a little bit of an orientation here. On the left, you can see I have in the very lower left what would be the southwest, Ireland. There's that northern part of Ireland. And then we're still looking at the image that is the left half of the screen there. You can see Scotland. And then there is a red rectangle that is an inset. So that red rectangle is part of the Inner Hebrides, the islands off the west coast of Scotland, but not so far off the coast to be the Outer Hebrides. And then on the right side is that inset. And just about in the middle of the screen there is that red coloration of the island of Iona. It is a small island that is just off the tip of the island of Mull. We'll look at the next slide. This is St. Columba's Bay on the Isle of Iona. So this is where Columba and the 12 who came with him in the small boat first landed. You can see the rocky shore, and the red there is a seaweed, that reddish kind of maybe auburn color, orangish color is seaweed. One day during our retreat, our group made a pilgrimage to Columba's Bay, and it was, as one might expect, even in the summertime in Scotland, a cold, a wet, a rainy day for a hike. When we made it across that part of the island and down to the bay, we then carried out a tradition, much like a tradition that I learned as a child at Flathead Lake United Methodist Camp. So I'll let you just look at that image a moment. Perhaps you've spent time on the shores of Flathead, on that beautiful jewel that we are privileged and blessed to have. Flathead Lake United Methodist Camp. Thank you. So one of the traditions at camp I think I've shared here, and it might not have been part of your generation, it was part of my generation, involved prayer rocks. And if I haven't said much about that, I will another time. The tradition there for all who make the pilgrimage to Columba's Bay is that we walk through the rocky shore, and then we listen for a rock to call to us. There may be a rock that was just drawing us. And when we have a sense of which rock is calling to us, then we pick it up. And the rock represents whatever might be a burden for us, whatever we might need to leave behind or release or shed, so that we can have some some clarity so that we can have some focus as we continue our journey with Jesus here in this world, here on the earth. And so we picked up a rock and then we threw it into the ocean. We'll look at one last slide. This is on another part of the island. In the lower left is the current abbey, an abbey that was rebuilt in the last century, in the 20th century. It goes back only to about 1200. So it was built about 700 years after Columba's first abbey, but there's very little that remains of what Columba and the other monks built in the 500s. Just ruins of rock. I think online people may be able to see this better in the photo than those of us in person, but I'll still describe it. You can see the sun, that is the sunrise, and it's coming through the clouds there. And up above where the sun is coming through the clouds, in the upper right-hand corner, is a bird. You may see the bird. I doubt that that bird is the dove of the church. Perhaps it's the bird that carries some peace, like a dove carries peace. There were doves on the island, but I think this might be a seagull. As usual, there were plenty of seagulls. And still for us, birds are reminders of the spirit who soars. Birds are reminders of that dove, the spirit who soars. Thank you. As time goes on, I will tell how Iona became a center of Christianity for all of Europe, and I offer the thought that who knows if Iona would have become a center but for Columba's humanity, but for his parting of company with those of his homeland and with his mentor and his teacher, Finian. Iona became an outpost for spiritual renewal. It became a place, a launching pad, a diving board, a place from which followers were sent and are still sent, are still launched to soar, to bring the good news of Christ's saving love to people all over the world. Columba's life is a witness to the truth that harm we caused in the past does not determine our future. Does not determine our future. We believe that God dreams a beautiful dream for us, something far better than being stuck in the past. What we see as exile, Columba and the 12 were exiled. What we see as exile in God's vision can be the dawn of a new day, as glorious as that sunrise in the last photo. And what we see as betrayal or abandonment or desertion, some kind of parting company, in Christ's vision can actually be the birth of a new community. Christ's vision, God's vision, may they be ours. We'll remain seated as we sing together, Be Thou My Vision. We now offer our tithes and our other material gifts to the Lord Jesus. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we celebrate the wonder of your unfolding purposes forever at work in ourselves, through these gifts, and in all the world. Amen. Please be seated.
I won't wave this too much around because my husband tends to like to grab a mic. So, but I do have a mic. It's on, as you heard, and Pastor Karen extended an open invitation to anyone who'd like to share a moment from their week, a thought they've had this morning, a prayer that they have on their heart, a joy. So I would be happy to bring this around. While you're thinking about that, because I don't want to catch you off guard, those of us who gave some thought to summer services really, our hearts have been touched, and a thank you goes out to all of you for building our community this summer, because look around. You're within, you know, distance of one another to be able to say hello, to give greetings, and it just really does our heart good to see how many of you have responded to that. Open mic.
Was 2 weeks old. His name is Aiden, so that's a great joy. And then I head off to Minnesota this week for another new beginning. My nephew's getting married, so lots of joy.
Absolutely.
I don't even like Deb.
I had the joy of having my son Grant, who's now 40 years old, and I can't believe it, with me and my husband for a week, and we had a great time with he and his wife. And then I've had bacterial pneumonia, and I am praising God that I am feeling like 95% again.
Okay, Sylvia, so nice to see you.
Thank you. I'm Sylvia Hesselwood. I just finished last spring 43 years of teaching. And my husband and I took off for the South and came back to snow in March. We have a lawn care business and have been really busy and working way too many days when we had the rain around here, and then we were playing catch up, but it's wonderful to be back. I just jumped ship and went up to Whitefish for a bit, and it's great to be back. My niece and my sister-in-law called me last weekend and said to me, "We haven't been over there for a while. They were here when our daughter graduated in 2007. And they made the trek and came in Wednesday night and said, "How many times did you do this?" Our family's in Central Washington. So it's great to be back here and be a part of this church family. It doesn't matter where you go, we're Methodists. And I know there's a lot of contention now in our church, but we don't have to feel that. We can still be the people that we were meant to be, and it's great to be here.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a real joy to take a look at the Share Your Bounty table today. It's loaded with lettuce. It still has some rhubarb and some herbs on it. So please help yourself.
I'm looking forward to the UMW retreat on Thursday. I hope that you can all come.
Is it in the bulletin? Oh.
We'll make sure we do that. We'll do that. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Have some details we'll share just for in-person folks in a moment.
You just run it around all over the place here. I just wanted to mention that, as far as I know at this point, the North Cuts are going to be here this next Sunday, here joining us in church. So if you know people around and come yourselves, hopefully we'll have a coffee afterwards to have a chance to visit and catch up on their lives and let them know how we're doing.
Please stand. We're turning in the Faith We Sing, if you would like the music. Faith We Sing to number 2130, The Summons. With the grace of God, our Creator, with the love and the hope of Jesus, our Savior, with the peace and the power of the Holy Spirit, our strength. Amen.